Yes, welcome to the next session of Design of Prestressed Concrete Elements course. In the last session, we were discussing the module number 2. In that module number 2, we have discussed one section, that is loss of prestress in the PSC member. So let us move to the next in the module number 2, that is the next bit or next part of module number 2. That is deflection of pre-stressed concrete member. Okay, so you people have come across this deflection aspect in the case of a reinforced concrete member. Likewise, let us know how the deflection will come in the case of pre-stressed concrete member. So let us go ahead. So the deflection of a flexural member is calculated to satisfy a limit state of serviceability. Full stop. The deflection is calculated for service loads. So as we know from the IS 456, so while dealing with the reinforced concrete structures, so you have come across the limit state of collapse and limit state of serviceability. Am I right? So in the limit state of collapse, you people have did the analysis and design of beams and slabs under flexure, shear, all those things. Likewise, you people have also come across the one more case of a limit state, that is a limit state of serviceability for a reinforced concrete member. So here also, the limit state of serviceability will come into the picture for a PSC member. So in those limited states of serviceability, that is limit state of serviceability, we come across a two aspects. One is deflection, another one is cracking. So these two aspects will come under limit state of serviceability. So we need to go ahead in order to calculate or know the deflection of PSC member. Is it clear? So as it states, the deflection of flexure, that means when it is subjected to bending, any member is subjected to bending. Okay, what will be the beam or a PSC member which undergo a deflection in such a way that which will be in the prescribed or serviceable limit, which will be in the prescribed or serviceable limit. So that you are going to do in the case of a deflection of PSC member. And this deflection you are going to calculate for service loads. That means when the beam is subjected to any service loads, okay, so those loads, service loads, okay, will make a beam to get deflects. So we are going to calculate those deflection under service loads. So now let me move to the next. So since is a very important aspect, since PSC member is small in depth than an equivalent reinforced concrete member, the deflection of PSC member tends to be larger. As we know that since we are using high strength concrete and high tensile steel in the PSC member, so as we discussed in module number 1, okay, so the advantage you are going to gain by using this material is you can reduce the section or cross sectional dimension. Am I right? So if the material is strong enough to bear the loads, that means you are going to reduce the cross sectional dimension or whatever the dimension of the section as compared to the reinforced concrete member, because this is an advantage in the case of PSC member because of high strength concrete and high tensile steel you are using inside the pre-stressed concrete member. So because of this reason, you can reduce the sectional dimension so that you can bring out the economy. So this is the advantage, okay, you people have come across. But compared to, okay, coming to the limb, what I can say, not disadvantage, somewhat I can say the thing we need to know, the deflection of PSC member will be larger. The deflection of a PSC member tends to be larger because of the lesser dimension or lesser cross-sectional dimension, it will undergo certain deflections. So we need to know those aspects. Is it clear? So next is, what are the factors that will influence the deflection of PSC member? So how this deflection of PSC member will vary or dependent? So the deflection of PSC member are influenced by the following factors. Number one, as you change the live load or imposed load and the self weight of a member, the deflection of PSC member will also vary. So this is the first factor. Okay, if the imposed load and self weight varies, the deflection of PSC member also varies. Okay, change in imposed load and change in self weight, okay, the deflection will be vary. Next, the one more aspect you need to learn in the case of a PSC member here is a very important aspect. See, in the reinforced concrete member, you people have analyzed the reinforced concrete member when the member is subjected to the gravity loads. That means if a reinforced concrete member subjected to gravity loads, you are going to analyze the deflection, whether it is in the permissible limit or prescribed limit or not. Am I right? But in this case, one more force will come, as we discussed and as we know, okay, that is the pre-stressing force. So apart from the gravity loads, that is dead load and live load, the pre-stressing force will also induce certain amount of deflection. Did you get my point? So hence, whatever the pre-stressing force, the magnitude you are going to induce inside the PSC member in order to induce a pre-compressive force inside the cable. So those things will also affect the deflection of PSC member. That means the pre-stressing force magnitude varies, the deflection will also vary. Next, coming to the cable profile. So we know from the load balancing concept that any external load we need to balance, we are going to put the cable in such a way that those external load will be in the form of a shape of a bending moment diagram. So that we came to know. For example, as I stated in the load balancing, if I'm going to subject the PSC beam to the UDL, okay, the bending moment diagram will be the parabola. So hence I'm going to induce a parabolic cable, okay, in order to take care of those stresses resulting from the external load. Am I right? So here also the same thing. By a cable profile, that means whether it is a straight cable, whether it is a parabolic cable, whether it is a sloping cable, whether it is a trapezoidal cable. So based upon those cable profile, the deflection pattern will vary. Did you get my point? Next, fourth one, second moment of area of section or moment of inertia of a section. Okay, so now coming to this aspect, so as the moment of inertia changes in the cross section, for example, if it is an I section, unsymmetrical I section, rectangular section, then the deflection will also vary. For example, if it is unsymmetrical I section, the deflection will be different. If it is a symmetrical I section, the deflection will be different. If it is a rectangular section, the deflection will be different. So based upon the moment of inertia, because we know that the moment of inertia for all the section will not be same. Am I right? For rectangular section, it will be BD cube by 12. For symmetrical I section, it will be different. For unsymmetrical I section, it will be different. So based upon the cross section of a PSC beam, the moment of inertia vary. As the second moment of area or moment of inertia varies, the deflection will also vary. Did you get my point? Next, modulus of elasticity of concrete. So that means as the modulus of elasticity of concrete varies or changes, the deflection will also start varying. Okay. Next, shrinkage, creep, and relaxation of steel. So these things we have been discussed in the laws of pre-stress also. So as these aspects varies, that is shrinkage, creep, and relaxation in the materials, so obviously the deflection will also change. Okay, next, the span of the member. So as the L changes in the PSC member, the deflection will also change. Next, fixity condition, very important. Fixity condition means whether it is fixed, simply supported or whatever the things. So it is called fixity conditions. So those fixity condition will also be very good. For example, if it is a fixed beam on either ends, obviously the deflection will be very less. If it is not fixed, if it is any other supports, obviously the deflection will change or it will be more. So these are the aspects or the factors or parameters that will influence the deflection of PSC member. So as these eight factors changes, the deflection will also change. Is it clear? So with this introduction part, that is regarding what is exactly the deflection, okay, and what are the factors that influence deflection. So the very simple way, as I stated, okay, I can say that deflection, that means if I'm going to subject to any external load, it will undergo certain amount of deformation. So those things will be called as deflection. If any member, a PSC member or something, okay, which will be subjected to the external loads, okay, so those external loads are with service load, okay, will undergo some deformation, will tend to form a deformation. So those things will be called as deflection. So whatever the deflection that has been happened due to the external load, okay, those deflection are whether within the permissible limit or prescribed limit, okay, those things we are going to learn in this particular topic. Is it clear? Okay. And apart from this, one more thing you people remember, that in RC member, you people have analyzed the RC member, okay, the subjected to gravity loads only. But in this case, one more force will come into the picture. So with respect to that, I should go ahead with the deflection calculation or analysis of deflection in the PSC member. Okay. Let us go ahead. So how to calculate that deflection? The total deflection in a PSC member is a resultant of upward deflection due to pre-stressing force and downward deflection due to gravity loads. So please note this point. So this is a very important thing. So now the total deflection in a PSC member is nothing but upward deflection due to pre-stressing force and downward deflection due to the gravity loads. So this is the formula, or this is the way I'm going to calculate the deflection in the PSC member. So as I stated, apart from the gravity load, we need to come across, or we need to go ahead with the pre-stressing force, because the pre-stressing force will also induce certain amount of deflection. And the downward deflection due to gravity loads will also induce certain deflection. So please observe the very important thing here. The pre-stressing force will induce upward deflection, because when I'm going to induce those pre-compression or magnitude of pre-stressing force at either ends, whatever the cable that has been induced, so that those things, that means the beam will tend to lift upwards. So that is called upward deflection, because of the compressive force applied. But in the case of a gravity loads, that is dead load and live load, as it is a transverse, or the load acting in the transverse direction, it will tend to deflect the beam downwards. So the net effect, that means upward deflection and the downward deflection, whatever the net effect will be retained. Okay, so those things will be called total deflection that has happened in a PSC member. Did you get my point? So this is the way you're going to calculate that deflection in a PSC member. Okay. Next, coming to the effect of tendile profile on deflection. So as I stated, so the cable profile is a factor that has influence on the deflection. How does the influence? Let us know. In PSC beams or member, the tendons are located with eccentricity. Okay, located with eccentricity towards the soffit of the beam, to counteract the sagging bending moment due to transverse load. I'll repeat. In PSC beam or member, tendons are located with eccentricity towards the soffit of the beam, that is bottom of the beam, to counteract the sagging bending moment due to transverse load. So this is nothing but a load balancing concept. So whatever the PSC beam that will be subjected to the transverse load, that is dead load and live load, will tend to create a sagging bending moment, that is downward. So those sagging bending moment will be counteracted by the cable or a tendon suitably placed at certain eccentricity. Did you get my point? Next, consequently, the concrete beam deflect upwards. Now, please remember, so whatever the sagging that has been happened, that means whatever the beam has tend to deflect downwards or deflecting downwards, so those PSC beam will be counterbalanced by applying this pre-stressing force, so that the beam, once the pre-stressing force is applied, will tend to lift upwards, so that the sagging bending moment will be counteracted and it will be nullified as far as possible. So this is the way we are going to counteract the bending or a deflection due to the transverse load. Did you get my point? So that is why the shape of the cable profile, or suitable cable profile, plays a very, very important role based upon the transverse load or based on the type of the transverse load acting on the beam. Is it clear? Fine. Next, the method of computing deflection of beam with different cable profiles are outlined below. So now let me take a different cases and the corresponding formula, so that you will come to know how exactly the different tendon profiles or a cable will behave, or how people have come across with a deflection calculation with various tendon profiles or cable profiles. So let us go one by one. So first, take straight tendons. So consider a PSC beam. Insert or induce a straight cable with a uniform eccentricity or constant eccentricity, XE. Let me put a magnitude of pre-stressing force P. And it is a simply supported and with a span L. Am I right? So now I'm going to talk only with respect to pre-stressing force. So please observe, I'm not going to consider any dead load or live load here. I'm going to talk with the deflection with respect to only the pre-stressing force. Not any other force will be considered here, whether it is dead load or whether it is live load. So let me go ahead. So once the PSC beam has been induced the straight cable, and to this straight cable, let me go ahead with the magnitude of pre-stressing force P is applied at the either of the ends. So as I stated, once the pre-stressing force is induced, the beam will tend to deflect upwards. So that deflection will be denoted by delta. So as I stated, as we know that, once the pre-stressing force is applied to the PSC member, the deflection will be maximum at the mid-span. Please note this point. The deflection will be maximum at the mid-span. So as it is go towards the support, the deflection will keep on reducing. Why? Because the bending moment will be maximum at the mid-span. Hence, I can say the deflection will also be maximum here. And please note this point, so that this upper deflection is going to happen purely because of pre-stressing force. Because I've already been told, when the pre-stressing force is induced, the beam will tend to induce an upper deflection. Is it clear? So that mid-span deflection delta is given by PE L square by 8EI. This is the formula. So here, earlier we used to derive the formula, so now we no need to derive the formula. So I'm just writing the formula for a different cases. So the mid-span deflection or central span deflection for a pre-stressing force P for a straight cable is PEL square by 8EI, and have been indicated minus. Why? Why it is minus? Because of upper deflection. If the beam tend to lift or deflect upwards, it will be indicated by negative sign. So please note this point. Okay, the pre-stressing force will induce upper deflection, and for that upper deflection with a straight cable, this will be the formula. PE L square by ATA with a negative sign, where negative sign will be the due to the deflection of beam upwards. Okay, next. So what is P? We already know pre-stressing force induced. E is the eccentricity, L is the span of the beam, and E is the modulus of elasticity of concrete. Please note this point. Modulus of elasticity of concrete. I is moment of inertia of a section. So this is the, okay, the parameters I'm going to assess. Okay, so let me move on to the next one. So next is parabolic tendons or central anchor. Okay, central anchor means I am going to put an anchor here so that the cable can stand firmly in the shape like this. That is what the anchor, because as I stated, so when you're going to put any cable inside the PSC member, okay, those PSC member we need to, okay, that means those cable we need to accommodate in such a way that this parabolic shape will be maintained inside the PSC beam, okay, throughout its lifespan. So in order to make this to happen, so I'm going to put a anchor at this point so that this will be, okay, anchored, or this will be at the shape of parabola. Did you get my point? So now consider the PSC beam with a parabolic cable, and I've been induced a pre-stressing force P, okay, which is having a mid-span eccentricity E, and that is support eccentricity zero. So for this also, the beam will tend to deflect upwards. So as I stated, okay, once the pre-stressing force is applied through the cable, okay, the beam will tend to deflect upwards. So for this, formula is equal to 5 PE into L square divided by 48 EI. 5 PE L square divided by 48 EI. You know what are all the things. And as I stated, negative sign indicates it will be tend to deflect upwards. Is it clear? So this is the formula you're going to use. That is mid-span deflection for a parabolic tendon, which is equal to minus 5 PE L square divided by 48 EA. Okay. Next, the same parabola which is having a support eccentricity. That means consider the same PSC beam. So which will be having a mid-span eccentricity some E1, and which will be having a support eccentricity E2. That means the whatever the, I can say, the eccentricity have been put, that means the cable have been put, okay, at the support will also be having certain amount of eccentricity. So that is delta is equal to, that is mid-span eccentricity is equal to PL square by 48 EA, same thing, PL square by 48 EA, PL square by 48 EA, multiply by minus 5 E1 plus E2. Okay, minus 5 E1 plus E2. Okay, so this is the formula. Okay, this minus and plus will be varied based upon the, okay, the eccentricity, that is below the centroidal axis and above the centroidal axis. Depending upon these conditions, this negative and positive sign will come into the picture. Okay, so this is the formula I am going to use in order to calculate the, okay, deflection for a parabolic tendon which is having a mid-span eccentricity and also the support eccentricity. Next, sloping tendons. So sloping tendons is nothing but eccentric anchors. Okay, here also the same thing. Okay, that is bent tendon. It is also called bent tendon or sloping tendon. So it will be having an eccentricity E1 at mid-span, and it will be having a support eccentricity E2 at the either of the edge. So once, if I'm going to subject the pre-stressing force to this particular cable like this, it will show a, okay, the deflection in the form of this. Okay, so please note down, this will be not a parabola. Okay, it will be something like, okay, what I can say, a triangular shape. Okay, now delta or mid-span deflection equal to PL square by 24 EI multiply by minus 2 E1 plus E2. I will repeat, mid-span deflection delta is equal to, for sloping tendon, PL square by 24 EI multiply by minus 2 E1 plus E2. So this is the formula for sloping tendon. Next, going with the trapezoidal tendon. Okay, so that means trapezoidal tendon will come into the picture only when the beam is subjected to two-point loading. So once the beam is subjected to two-point loading, at that particular circumstances, you will come across the trapezoidal profile. Did you get my point? So for this trapezoidal profile, as I stated, the L1, L2 length will be varying. Okay, from the midspan up to the kink point, it will be L2. Okay, and this triangular distance, I can say it is L1. Okay, that is this distance is L1. Okay, so for this, how to calculate the deflection? That is delta, which is the midspan deflection, is equal to minus P by 6 EI into 2L1 square plus 6 L1 L2 plus 3 L2 square. So this is the formula, okay, we are going to use to calculate the midspan deflection for the trapezoidal tendon. Is it clear? So like this, we need to calculate the midspan deflection, okay, based upon the profile of the cable. So please note down, I have not been derived the formulas. So directly I have been written the formulas. So based upon the condition. Is it clear? So let me, okay, so this is about the various profiles and their corresponding deflections. Okay, so now you came to know how to calculate the upward deflection, okay, when the PSC beam is subjected to the pre-stressing force with depending upon the various type of cable profile. Okay, so let me move on further. So the next is coming to the deflection due to self-weight and imposed. So till now we have been discussed the deflection of PSC beam due to pre-stressing force. So now let us know the deflection of a PSC beam due to self-weight and imposed load. Because I have been stated the deflection is going to happen because of dead load, live load and the pre-stressing force. So let us know now dead load and live load deflection. So now at the time of transfer of pre-stress, the beams arc up due to the effect of pre-stressing. So these things you came to know now. Okay, at the time of transfer of pre-stressing force, the beam will tend to arc. Okay, the beam will tend to arc. That means that beam will tend to lift upwards. Arcing means lifting upwards. Sagging means deflecting downwards. Okay, so these beams will tend to arc. Why? Because of the effect of pre-stressing force. Full stop. At this stage, self-weight of the beam induces downward deflection, which further increases due to the effect of imposed load on the beam. So now, till now, we have not come across a situation that is a PSC beam subjected to the dead load and live load. Till now, we were discussing only the beam deflection or PSC member deflection only due to the pre-stressing force. That means the beam will tend to deflect upwards. So now the situation will come in such a way that the dead load, once the PSC beam is subjected to dead load and live load, the beam will start deflecting downwards. Okay, and this effect will increase because of increase in the imposed load. Did you get my point? So let me know how to calculate the deflection for this particular case. So we know that the self-weight of the beam will be denoted by WDL or WD, and live load on the beam will be denoted by WL. So now, please note down. So let me write down the diagram. So now the very important aspect you need to know here is, so as I stated, the dead load will always be UDL. No change in the dead load. No change in the dead load. Okay. So the dead load will always be UDL. Please note this point. But this live load in this particular case, it is UDL. Please note this point. So live load in this particular case, it is acting like a UDL with a span length of L. So now this will be the deflection delta. So for this particular case, the formula is equal to delta is equal to phi into WD plus WL into L to the power of 4 divided by 385. Why I'm using this formula? We know from the basic analysis, that is structure analysis class, when a PSC beam is subjected to a UDL, the deflection will be given by phi WL to the power of 384 EI. But here the W, that is WD and WL, will be considered together. Why? Because this dead load and live load are acting as a UDL. This dead load and live load are acting as a UDL. So hence I have been written this formula. Did you get my point? If the dead load and live load changes, okay, the formula will change. So let us know that. Okay, so now this is the formula for a PAC beam once it is subjected to UDL. So now, so that's what I've been written here, note WLL is UDL. So now please come to the note here. If WLL is a central concentrated load, that means instead of subjecting a PAC member with a UDL, if I subject the PAC member with a central concentrated load or point load, then the formula will change as to, okay, WLQ by, okay, instead of P, you can write WL. That means I can write like this, delta is equal to WOL into LQ divided by 48 EI. So this is the formula when the PAC beam is subjected to central concentrated load. Now, what about the dead load? How to calculate the dead load for this particular case? Okay, so for that, dead load will always be acting as a UDL. The formula remains same. That is, W is equal to 5WL to the power of 4 divided by 384 EI. No change in the dead load. Did you get my point? In this particular case, both are UDL, hence I am using this formula. In this particular case, since the PAC beam is acting with a central concentrated load, here the live load, now it is be changes like this. Now, it will be like this. This is the case. So now the PAC beam is subjected to central concentrated load. Okay, that is WL. Let me call it as WL. Now for this particular case, the downward deflection due to the live load is this much. The downward deflection due to dead load equal to 5WL to the power of 4. Okay, that is WD into L to the power of 4 divided by 384 EI. Did you get my point? Fine. So next, if the same, okay, the live load is 3-point loading, a third point loading, okay, that is 1/3 point, that means if it's subjected to, okay, like this, for example, one sec. If the same beam, if I'm going to, okay, this will be the PAC beam, okay, and this will be the, what I can say, the central axis, this will be the loading, okay. If I subject to the 1/3 loading, okay, so this is L by 3 and L by 3. So this is called 1/3 loading, okay. So L by 3. So for this particular case, the live load will be given by 23 PL cubed divided by 648 EI. I will repeat, deflection at mid span, that is downward deflection at mid span due to the 2-point loading equal to 23 PL cubed divided by 648 EI. So this is the formula. Likewise, if I want to calculate the deflection for a dead load, then the same formula, 5WD into L to the power of 4 divided by 384 EI. Because as I stated, the dead load always will be acting as UDL. Is it clear? So this is regarding your downward deflection due to the self weight and the imposed load. So three circumstances you are going to come across. One is UDL, and it may be central concentrated load, or it may be 2-point load. So three cases it may come in the exam. So next, so as I stated, this will be one type of deflection. If you want to calculate the short term deflection, okay, that is the type of deflection. One is long term, another one is short term. So if you want to calculate the short term deflection at transfer, then the short-term deflection due to transfer is equal to, okay, that is delta PF, that is magnitude of deflection due to precessing force, which will be upward, hence it is negative, plus the deflection due to the self-weight, and it may be precessing also, okay, deflection due to self-weight. So hence it, since it is a downward deflection, it will be positive. So why, yes, it will not be considered a live load or WL, because during transfer, no live load will be coming to the picture. Still, the PAC beam is still in factory. Okay, still the beam is in factory. So, nowhere the PAC beam is subjected to service load. Hence, the short-term deflection at transfer will be given by this formula. Did you get my point? So, these are all the formula you need to remember, okay, while doing the analysis or while calculating the deflection of a PAC member. So hope you have understood the concept. Okay, I will just conclude. Okay, when a PSC beam is subjected to the any type of load, that is two types of loads. One is the PSC beam will be subjected to the pre-stressing force, and another one is it will be subjected to the gravity loads. So those gravity loads includes dead load and live load. The pre-stressing force induced through the cable will induce or will put the upward deflection, will make upward deflection. And the PSC beam, which is subjected to the gravity loads, will tend to create downward deflection. So if the PSC beam tend to deflect upwards, why? Because of pre-stressing force, it will be negative. If a PSC beam tend to deflect downwards because of gravity loads, that is dead load and live load, then it is positive. Did you get my point? So this is the way you are going to calculate the total deflection or resultant deflection of a PSC member. And this will vary based upon the condition. That is, in the case of pre-stressing force, the formula will be varied based upon the type of a profile and the eccentricity. Okay, that means whether it is a straight cable, whether it is a parabolic cable, in the parabolic cable, whether it is having a midspan eccentricity and end eccentricity zero, or whether it is having a midspan eccentricity E1 and end eccentricity E2. So like this, depending upon the type of a profile and the eccentricity, the formula will vary. And in also coming to the case of gravity loads, based upon the live loads, the deflection will also vary. So that's what I've been told, the factors influencing, that is based upon the imposed load, based upon the cell weight, based upon the magnitude of pre-stressing force, based upon the type of the profile. So all these factors will influence on the deflection of a PSC member. So hope you have understood the concept. Okay, so this is the way you are going to calculate the deflection and how to go ahead with this deflection calculation. Okay, based upon the condition, I'm going to teach you while doing the problem. Okay, so let me go ahead with a further case. So now next is limits of deflection. So once if you calculate the deflection of a PSC beam, or the deflection of a PSC member. So as I stated in the previous, okay, that means whether it is subjected to, okay, that means which type of gravity loads, which type of profile, you are going to calculate the total deflection. Am I right? You are going to calculate the total deflection for a particular PSC member. Now, after calculating the total deflection, now we need to check whether the calculated deflection is within the permissible limit or not, or within the limits of deflection or not. Am I right? Because as we know from the basics that we are allowing the beam to get crack, we are allowing the beam to get deflect. So that's what the limit state of serviceability says. We cannot, pretend the deflection or crack to happen, because we need to allow certain amount of tensile stresses, we need to allow certain amount of bending. Otherwise, what is going to happen, it is going to show the sudden collapse or something. So in order to take care of this, we are allowing the cracks, that is what the cracking depth or cracking, and we are allowing the beam to get deflect. Did you get my point? That is what the limit state of serviceability says. We cannot encounter, we cannot counterbalance the complete stresses. Okay, we cannot counterbalance the complete deflection. Okay, we cannot counterbalance the cracking. So the beam should allow certain amount of cracks. The beam should go ahead with certain amount of deflection. Okay, but whatever the deflection that has been happened, so those deflection, what I want to say is, should be within the permissible limits or limits of deflection as per the IS. So that is what the thing we need to check. Okay, let me go ahead. So as per the clause 19.3.1, page 39. Okay, so little bit clarity is less. Please try to adjust. I'm sorry for this. As per the clause 19.3.1, page 39 of IS 1343, 1980 and 2012 code. So there you can come across, as per the clause 19.3.1, page number 39, both in 1980, that is IS 1343, 1980 and 2012, because we know that this is the code codal provision we are going to use for PSC member, that is 1343, 2012 or 1980. Okay, now we have started to use this 2012. Okay, so specifies the limits of deflection. So this code will specify the limits of deflection such that the efficiency of the structural element and the appearances of the finishes or partitions are not adversely affected. Okay, so whatever the guidelines that has been given in this particular clause, okay, which will specifies the limits. So what should be the limit? What should be the deflection? In order to take care or in order to increase the efficiency of the structural element and appearances of the finishes. That means finishes means whatever the things that means you have been put. Okay, that is finishing, plastering, all those things. So those things, okay, without undergoing any deflection or cracking, okay, without getting adversely affected, okay, whether which is in the permissible limit or not. So that clause, okay, that condition you are going to check based upon this particular class. So now the deflection shall generally be limited to, so whatever the deflection you are going to calculate or do, okay, so those deflection we need to limit to certain things. So as per IS 1343, 2012 or 1980, what is that? The final deflection or whatever the deflection you're going to calculate due to all loads, that means dead load, live load, pre-stressing force, everything. That is my meaning of all loads, including apart from the load. So please, please listen. Okay, whatever the deflection or formula we have been discussed till now, okay, so that will be purely based upon the loads. So apart from these things, the beam will also undergo certain amount of deflection. So that will be due to the effect of temperature. Okay, that means the PSC beam will be subjected to various condition. Okay, it will be subjected to summer, winter, rainy, everything. So that is called temperature variations. Okay, next, it will be subjected to the creep, the effect of creep and effect of shrinkage. Okay, all those things and measured from the, okay, the as cast level, okay, as from the level of the supports of floors, okay, roofs and all other horizontal members should not normally exceed span by 250. That means whatever the deflection you are going to calculate due to considering all the loads and considering the temperature effect, creep effect, shrinkage effect, and measured from the cast instrument, that is level of the support of floors, roofs, everything, and all the horizontal member should not exceed the span divided by 250. So it should not exceed this ratio, span by 250 ratio. So this is the one condition. Next, if the deflection includes the effect of temperature, creep and shrinkage occurring after erection of partitions and application of finishes, that means this I can say before finishing or okay, what I can say. Now, the deflection we are going to assess or calculate after the erection of partitions and the application of finishes. That means the final, whatever the thing we want to do, everything we are going to finish. After finishing all these things, okay, whatever the deflection that is going to happen due to various aspects should not normally exceed span by 350, should not normally exceed span by 350 or 20 mm, whichever is less. Okay, so it may be span by 350 or 20 mm, whichever is less. So based on this condition, whatever the deflection that has happened in the PSC member should not cross this limit. Did you get my point? Next, if finishes are applied to the PSC member, comma, the total upward deflection, okay, should not exceed span by 300. Upward deflection will be induced due to what? Due to the pre-stressing force. That means by considering the only the pre-stressing force, okay, if finishes are applied to the PSC, then whatever the deflection, that is upper deflection that is going to happen in the PSC member should not exceed span by 300. Unless uniformity of camber between the adjacent units can be ensured. That means camber means that is the deflection or whatever the cable that has been induced, the type of a cable. Okay. So this is regarding the limits. Okay, you need to go. Okay, so these things I'm going to use in the calculation of deflection, because whatever the deflection your people are going to calculate, okay, based upon the condition, so those deflection I'm going to check whether which is in the permissible limit or not. So those things I'm going to do. Is it clear? Next, limits of span to effective depth ratio. Okay, so now what will be the span to effective depth ratio? The code has given are limited. L by D ratio, very simple L by D ratio limits. So because based upon L by D ratio only, the deflection will, what I can say, vary. Okay, because I've been told in the factors, the span of the member, the cross-sectional dimension, so all those factors will affect. So based upon that, so let us see what the provision has given by the code. Okay, the calculation of deflection can be bypassed. The calculation of deflection can be bypassed if the span to effective depth ratio is within the specified limit. Okay, it can be bypassed. The deflection calculation can be bypassed or overcrossed if the span to effective depth, that is L by D ratio, is within the permissible limit. Okay, so let us know what is that. The limits of L by D ratio as per clause are 22.6.2, okay, of IS 1343-2012. So based upon this, okay, I have not been mentioned in the page number here, so please refer that page number. So the, but I've been mentioned the clause 22.6.2. so those clause in IS 1343-2012 has clearly specified what should be the L by D ratio for a PSC member. What should be the L by D ratio for a PSC member? So let us know. For a span which is lesser than or equal to 10 meter, I will repeat, for a span lesser than or equal to 10 meter, for cantilever beam, L by D ratio should be lesser than or equal to 7. For simply supported beam, L by D ratio lesser than or equal to 20. For continuous beam, L by D ratio should be lesser than or equal to 26. I think these things you've been come across while analyzing our design of beams in the case of a reinforced concrete member. The same thing I've been repeating here, how to consider the L by D ratio, okay, based upon the span in the case of PSC member as per IS 1343-2012. Did you get my point? Next, if the span is more than 10 meter, okay, if it is not lesser than 10 or equal to 10, if it is more than 10 meter, for simply supported beam, L by D ratio, okay, or L by D lesser than or equal to 20 into 10 by L. So this is the formula. For continuous beam, L by D should be lesser than or equal to 26 into 10 by L. Okay, so this is the factor they are going to multiply, okay, to the above things, that is 20 and 26. So by this, you are going to check, or we are going to know the L by D ratio, or effective span to effective depth, or span to effective depth ratio you are going to come across. So these things are very, very important. Okay, you need to know, okay, as per IS 1343-2012 or 1980. So these are all the things, okay, we need to be very thoroughly understand while going with a problem. Okay, because while doing a problem, so these aspects you should know, okay, to judge or to understand the nature of PSC beam. Okay. So this is the conditions I'm going to use. Okay, so this is regarding your what I can say, the deflection of a PSC member. So hope you have understood the concepts. Okay, so this is the regarding the theory part. So with these theory background, or with these concepts background, so let us proceed with the problem in the next class or in the next session. So I'm going to do the various problems, or we are going to calculate the deflection of PSC member for various condition. Is it clear? So with this, I'm going to wind up the today's session. So thank you for joining.